Welcome, everyone. It's great to be here. Now, there's one thing that we know for sure, that nature is good for us. We've known this for millennia. 2,000 years ago, Taoist monks wrote about the healing powers of working in greenhouses and tending gardens. And in 1984, E.O. Wilson wrote about our deep primal need to affiliate with nature and the natural world and coined the term biophilia. This concept of biophilia is becoming ever more urgent as we consume the biodiversity around us and separate ourselves more and more from the natural world. As of 2010, we have officially become an urban species. More of us live in cities than don't, and that is a trend that's continuing and accelerating. It has progressively drawn us inside, away from the natural world. And now the average North American and European spends 90% of their time indoors. That remaining 10%? Well, 5 of that is spent in a car, if not more. I hear some commuters laughing in the audience. This is an environment very different from our ancestral origins, and it's a relatively modern thing. So how has this radical shift in lifestyle affected our minds and body? Well, there are a slew of studies chronicling the modern ailments that go along with the separation from the natural world. And they're physical as well as mental. And some of these include spreading epidemic of myopia. If you don't get enough sunlight on your eyeballs, they grow longer and we get myopia. We have rising levels of obesity and diabetes, cardiovascular diseases correlated with a lack of nature exposure, and all sorts of behavioral disorders. Depression is rampant. So what is going on and how can nature help? Well, nature's a complicated therapy. It's not only rich in visuals, it's multisensorial. You have incredible sounds and tastes and textures, interrelationships and processes. It's a complex therapy. How do you figure out what's doing what? Well, you can start to look at it by breaking it into its component parts and, let's say, visuals. Now, I'm a marine biologist, and I've spent many, many hours studying this crazy fish, the giant ocean sunfish, and other large animals. And I love being immersed in nature. I find it completely exhilarating and rejuvenating. But what I find particularly interesting as well is that just looking at nature imagery does something powerful to our brains and bodies. There's something going on there. We're not in nature, we're looking at it. So what's that mechanism? Well, Robert Ulrich was the first to really formally write about this and publish a scientific study in 1984 in Science, in the journal Science. And he found that recovering patients from gallbladder surgery who had windows that looked out on trees had a faster recovery rate, upwards of a day faster, and requested fewer strong pain medication than those patients whose windows look out on a brick wall. And since those studies, many have followed suit and found similar things. There's a number of theories that have been put forth to describe and explain what's going on. And one of the prevailing theories is put forth by Rachel and Stephen Kaplan out of the University of Michigan. And it's called attention restoration theory. You have your directed attention, your voluntary attention, and your involuntary attention. And nature, it has our involuntary attention. It draws us in with this kind of what psychologists call a soft fascination that doesn't take much effort. You look at the clouds overhead, you look at the wind rustling the leaves, and your attention is drawn, but it's not taxing you, as opposed to directed attention where if you're driving, you have to, you know, stay focused on these things. And nature is restorative in this way. So that's one of the prevailing theories, and there's lots of different ones as well. And there's ways of testing this. You can take bits of saliva and look for cortisol, which is a measure of stress levels. You can put on galvanic skin sensors. You can put on heart rate monitors. But what if you could crawl right inside the mind? Now, wouldn't that be cool? So that's what we're looking at now. And I'm calling this neurobiophilia, the science of how nature engages the brain. And this is a subdiscipline. It joins other subdisciplines that are looking at the brain and how the brain responds to our environments. And they include things such as neurocinematics, the brain on movies. There's also neuroaesthetics, the brain on beauty and art. And what I find really exciting about these subdisciplines is that they're highly interdisciplinary. They're drawing from all sorts of different venues, all sorts of different disciplines, from social science to evolutionary psychology to computer science, artificial intelligence, landscape architecture, color theory, and they're pulling it all together to make sense of what's going on in the brain. We have our toes on the shores of this vast cerebral sea. And it's such an exciting time to have these tools available for these explorations. And to continue our adventure into the brain, I'm going to hand off to Tan. So thanks for listening.
Thank you, Tierney. And good evening, everyone. You know, I spend most of my day in front of a computer screen. I basically do a lot of reading. I look at a lot of numbers, measurements, and I coordinate people because I've spent the last 10 years of my life working to develop new technologies that allow us to study brains. You know, this amazing and yet enigmatic space inside our head. And as we go through life, our brain actually undergoes extraordinary development. It's the most adaptive organ in our body. And it can change both positively and negatively by our thoughts, actions, and experiences. And we know, as neuroscientists, that nature has a restorative effect on the brain. Now, the way in which most of these experiments are conducted is based on giving people a sustained attention task that drains and fatigues your attentional networks. And then you're asked to spend about 30 minutes in nature or in an urban setting, and then you're brought back into the same place and asked to do the same test again, and you're measured to see your performance, which one did you do better in. And whilst that's a really good way to observe the effects and the beneficial effects of nature on the brain, it's not quite the same as being able to measure and quantify exactly what is going on in the brain itself. And that's the question that the three of us wanted to answer. We wanted to actually measure and quantify exactly what is going on in my brain when I experience those amazing imagery of nature. And so one of the things that really excites me the most about brain research in the last decade is that we have moved beyond psychology, psychiatry, and neurology, and we've merged with other disciplines: statistical analysis, artificial intelligence, machine learning, even material sciences, information technology, with advances in technology contributing to ever better, faster, and smarter devices and techniques. One of the things that we're trying to do is to really push the boundaries of the latest in science and technology to enable these portable electroencephalogram systems to open a new window on the complex functioning of our brain. And I wanted to take a few moments to share with you and really show you an insight into what my brain actually looks like in real time. So if we switch over, there you are. So this is this device is picking up my brain activity right now and transmitting it to a computer. And so what you're able to see is a data visualization tool that localizes the activity in different functional brain areas. So when you see the frontal part of my brain light up, the frontal lobes are responsible for executive function, conscious thoughts, movements, attention, planning, language, logic. The side of my brains, the temporal lobes, are responsible for processing auditory responses, memory. And the back of my brain, when you see that part light up, the parietal and occipital lobes, that's actually responsible for sensory integration and visual processing. And so through tools like this, we can actually have a window into what's going on in real time. And that allows us to really start to piece together the beneficial effects of nature on the brain in a way that we haven't really been able to see in the past. And so with that, I'm going to pass on to Nalini to end our...
Thanks. Oh, that's great. I can't believe I just saw my colleague's brain going on, but that was fantastic. And really, that's the wonderful thing about a collaboration like ours. There's so much sharing and learning that goes on. I've learned, for example, that the different parts of a neuron, a single neuron, one of the billions that occur in our brain, they function in a way to connect the thoughts and the actions and the knowledge that we have within our bodies and outside our worlds. And I'd like to share with my colleagues anything I can tell them about trees, because that's what I study. And I have been studying forest trees for many years. I study in the forest canopy. I started 35 years ago, and that was a time when we were pioneers in the forest canopy, where very few people had ascended. Well, that beautiful tapestry of the intact forest canopy is being destroyed by many human activities. And I became very concerned about this, the disturbances of deforestation, of forest fragmentation, of conversion of primary forest to agricultural land. Another environmental problem that I became very interested in is the harvesting of canopy-dwelling mosses for the horticulture trade. This is a $300 million business, and it wouldn't sound so bad unless you realize that it takes 30 years, 20 to 30 years, for these mosses to grow back after they've been stripped off of old-growth forest trees. And as a scientist, I felt that maybe I could do something about this environmental problem, and I realized I couldn't stop the collecting of mosses, but perhaps I could learn how to farm these mosses in order to bring down the harvesting pressure in these beautiful old growth systems. And it also seemed to me that I needed help to do this. And it also seemed to me that perhaps people who didn't have access, people who don't have access to nature or to these beautiful mosses in this incredible temperate rainforest might be the best possible partners. And so I started a program in 2005 to enlist the help of prisoners, of incarcerated men and women, to help me learn how to grow mosses for the horticulture trade. They have time, many of them have space, you don't need sharp tools to grow mosses. And so in fact, this turned out to be a fabulous project. The incarcerated men and women enjoyed this project and got something out of it because they found that they were contributing to something larger than themselves, something larger than the prison in which they were incarcerated, something as large as planet Earth, because they were helping to reduce collecting pressure of these old growth ecosystems. And the supervisors and superintendent loved this project because the men were occupied. They were having better social interactions. Violent infractions started going down. And so they asked me to organize more projects. I started a science lecture series in this prison that spread to others. And from those lecture series became the inspiration for starting some conservation projects. These involved growing endangered species, prairie plants, the Oregon spotted frog, the Taylor checker spot butterfly, by the inmates behind bars. When these animals and plants were produced, they were taken by our collaborating conservation groups and used for restoration projects in Washington State. This was really a win-win situation for the men and women that we were able to bring these projects to, but I very soon realized that I was missing people in the prison in terms of people who could be involved with these projects. That is, I was missing the men and women who were incarcerated far deep in the bowels of the prison system of the United States, those that live in solitary confinement. Over 30,000, some estimate up as high as 80,000 men and women, are incarcerated in solitary confinement in the United States. This is a cell, 9 by 12. You can see it's very bare of really anything. They're incarcerated in the cell for 23 hours a day. Their meals are brought to them. And 1 hour a day, they are brought out by two guards to their exercise rooms or their recreational space, which again is a very bare room with very little in terms of stimulation and absolutely no exposure to nature at all. And it seemed to me that maybe, although we couldn't bring in frogs and butterflies and soil and plants, that we might be able to bring nature imagery to these exercise cells so that at least for 1 hour a day, they would be exposed to some element of nature and nature imagery. We started this out at the invitation of a wonderful, well, I don't know if I can say a wonderful prison, but in any case, a prison where wonderful people work, the Snake River Correctional Institution in Ontario, Oregon. They installed a projector in one of the exercise rooms of one of the cell blocks there. They were able to gather natural history films from the web and various other places. And so right now, the men who are in solitary confinement can ask to see one of the films when they go into their exercise room. And there they can choose one of the 30 films that has been made available to them. And then they're able to watch that film. And for that 1 hour a day, they're being exposed to nature imagery. We have some anecdotal information that this has been very positive in terms of bringing down stress and anxiety. But we have to do more work in terms of understanding how this might become an intervention. We need to understand the real impacts of this on the attitudes and the behavior of the inmates that are exposed to it. We also recognize that it's not just the incarcerated men and women who are exposed to this nature deficit situation. It's also the staff, the officers, and the people who work in this environment that undergo what they call decomposition of physical, emotional, and psychological behavior as they're removed from nature and nature imagery. This is true not only in solitary confinement prisons, but increasingly, as Tierney pointed out, in our own society. People who work in windowless offices in cubicles like this, people who have jobs in toll booths, people who work in military barracks. My own mom, who's 91 years old and is in a senior assisted living center in Rockville, Maryland here, has very little in the way of interaction with nature or nature imagery. So I think there's tremendous potential to think about the things that Tierney and Tan have talked about and the kinds of things that we'd like to do to eventually apply what we know to the kinds of populations that we will be a part of increasingly as time goes forward. I think that our collaboration has allowed us to just sort of, as Tierney said, put our toes into the very first little waves of understanding humans and the brain. But I'd like to just share with you three of the beginning conclusions that we have come up with so far. First of all, we've come to understand that if we want to understand nature and the brain, we must use both the cognitive sides of our ability to understand as well as the emotional side. Both of those are intertwined if we're to understand nature and the brain. Secondly, we need to collaborate. It's great to have this threesome of colleagues, but there are other fields that must be drawn into this. Neuroscience, ecopsychology, sociology, all of these fields must come together and touch in points where we can make contact and help each other understand this complexity of nature and the brain. And the third concluding idea that we've come up with as a result of our collaboration is that nature is necessary for human social resilience. That is, nature is needed by everyone. Thank you.